Big Buck Registries Big Buck Podcast, episode number 17. Big Buck Registry is a virtual museum of hunting stories. We preserve a piece of Americana by interviewing and recording hunters about their hunts and experiences from across the country. And who knows, maybe we'll learn a thing or two along the way that'll help us take our hunt to the next level.
Hey everyone, this is Doug Borries from Dynamic Outdoors and DynamicOutdoors.net, and you're listening to the show I never miss. We'll be right back with Big Buck Registry's Big Buck Podcast.
Welcome to the show, everybody. This is your host, Jay Scott of the Big Buck Registry's Big Buck Podcast, and this is episode number 17, and I am here with my good friend, Dusty Phillips, our field correspondent from Ohio and creator of Chubby Tines Outdoors. Dusty Phillips, what's going on, Dusty?
Man, it's going to be a good night on the podcast. That's for dang sure.
Yeah, why do you say that?
You know, I can't tell you that right now, but we'll get to that. What's going on in your neck of the woods?
Wait, what do you mean you can't tell me?
Well, we got a special guest tonight, and I think you're going to like it. But we're going to leave that alone for right now. Well, what's going on in your neck of the woods?
Man, I can't even think straight now. You got me all wound up. All right. So what's going on up here in New Hampshire? We've got, the foliage is kind of starting to wane a little bit. I'm getting that smell in the air that smells like deer hunting. Getting some warm days, so like some of the days are not feeling like hunting yet, but those evenings and mornings, boy, it's really getting me jazzed up. It's just you know that time of year is here.
And it's time to lay the creeper.
It is. Time to get outside. Everybody who's listening to this, I hope you're on your way to your tree stand right now. Hopefully it's 5 a.m. You just clicked on your iPhone or whatever application you're using, and you're starting to listen to the show, and you're driving to your deer stand as you're listening to this. That's what I hope for everybody right now.
Yeah, I hope everybody gets in the woods and shoots a monster this morning.
Yep, because there is nothing like being outside in the presence of some kind of game animal while you're in the fall. There's nothing like it.
It don't get no better.
It doesn't. It doesn't. Except unless you're with your son or daughter. That's like the ultimate for me.
Right on.
Yep.
So the weather and the leaves are starting to fall. The weather's changing. Yep. You got it. It's starting to stir up in your neck of the woods.
Yep. And if you're a longtime hunter, you're starting to get that little twinkle in your eye. Like, oh yeah. Finally.
It's almost Christmas morning.
It really is. It's like Christmas.
Right on. Yeah.
Yep.
Same thing here in Ohio. Yeah.
Rifle season eve, you know, that kind of thing. I mean, it's bow
deer
season
camp.
Eve, deer camp.
Deer camp. Yeah. It's all coming around.
All those great familiar things that it just brings you right back to great moments in your life that you just dream about. It's just,
you know, you've almost got me convinced to put the headset down, get out of the studio and go to the woods.
It's nighttime, Dusty.
But, you know, you had me convinced that it was, you know, full-blown opening morning here.
I know. This is a pre-recorded show, but it comes out at 5 o'clock a.m. every Saturday morning. So,
how else could you ever start your weekend off? You know, 5 o'clock, Big Buck Registry, Big Buck Podcast. You know, it don't get no better. Headed to the tree stand, you got the Big Buck Podcast on. I don't know if life could get any better.
I'm liking it. I'm a fan of the show too. I don't know if I listen to the show. Like, we record it. My wife looked at me the other day, goes, how many times are you going to listen to that? I said, well, I record it and I kind of remember what we talked about. And then I fast forward through everything to cut out all the parts that don't sound great. But it's like two times the speed. So I don't really hear it. I kind of get to the spots that I remembered had issues or things we had to clear up. But I actually don't listen to it until it comes out that morning.
Like, right on.
Listen to it. So I get to enjoy it just as everybody else does.
You know, I'm going to do one thing this on this show. I'm going to shout out to all the listeners out there. I mean, I tell you what, you all rock. That's all there is to it. You're awesome people. And we appreciate you all tuning in, listening to the Big Buck Roastery, Big Buck Podcast. And, you know, be ready for this season. It's coming. We got some awesome people. We got some real detailed, you know, podcasts coming up. There's going to be some good information along with some great people.
I'll second that. Don't we have the best fans in the world?
We have the awesome. There's no other fans. The ones we got are the best.
They are. I absolutely love our fans. They're so cool. I am over the last weekend, I sent out a request on the Big Buck Registry, and I said, and we do have that, a phone number that 724-613-2825, which spells Buck 2825 does, where you can text us or call us or leave us a message and tell us about your hunt, your whatever, your story, whatever's going on. I actually had guys from, let's see, New York all the way down to Georgia texting me Saturday morning when they saw a deer. Like, I had 3 doe and a 6-pointer come through just now. And guys I have never talked to.
That's awesome.
Isn't that cool?
That's very cool. You know, that's what we're all about. We want to know what's going on in the hunting woods all around the world. You know, that's why the number's there to text in. Let us know what's going on. That, you know, reach out to us and give us some information, and we can pass it along. You know, we had I think there was a guy in Ohio text that he had 3 does and that he'd seen 4 decent bucks throughout the whole day. You know, and that text us in. Tell us.
Yeah.
Tell us what's going on in your neck of the woods.
I mean, that energy that comes from that, where people are interacting, and it gets you excited about your spot. Doesn't matter where it is. I could be in New Hampshire. I could text into the Big Buck Registry, hey, just had a 6-pointer walk by and 3 does, and you could be in your tree stand in Ohio and get that text through the Facebook if you're on your iPhone or whatever. You could, because of the advent of smartphone technology, you can actually get on Facebook while you're in your stand. If nothing's going on, you're just looking around. You can actually interact with other hunters. You know,
yeah,
this whole network across the country.
That makes me stay in the woods because somebody else in Ohio just had seen a couple. I'm like, man, maybe it's my turn.
That's exactly right. And you know what happens when you stay longer?
You see more.
You see more deer, and you get the one you want. That's right.
Hey, I was going to tell you about who we got on the show today, but I'm still holding out on that.
Dude, you're killing me.
that's just part of it. I'm holding out. We're going to talk for a little bit longer here, get you guys all pumped up about getting in the woods this morning, and then we'll get into who's on the show. We had some rain here, Jay, and it's kind of messed things up a little bit. Kind of got them back in the lull, I think, you know, and that's okay, though. Definitely needed a little more rain. Not really, but we got it. And it's made them bed up a little bit. We had an overnighter, and it rained hard here last night, which would be Wednesday evening, or Tuesday evening, sorry about that. And, you know, no activity hardly on the trail camera overnight. Midday today, had a couple does come in. I checked my trail cameras before I went in the woods, and it's not happening just yet. It's close.
Okay.
They said the musty, leaf rotten smell is definitely in the air. It's getting real close to being real active in our woods here in Ohio, but right now it's still pretty slow, you know, and I'm sure other hunters are experiencing the same thing. It's slow. There's not a lot going on in the woods, but you know, you never know. Right now is the time that you could whack a big one. You just never know.
You never know. You never know. Well, it's good to get a report from Ohio, because that's just like deer mecca. You guys just have big deer there. So cool. I wanted to bring up a topic here. I started watching a show on Netflix, just came on Netflix, I think, and my friend turned me on to it, and it's called Northwoods Law. And you said that you had seen some of that show. Is that right?
I sure have.
I was, I'm just mesmerized by how close that is to New Hampshire. That's life in New Hampshire. And it's based out of Maine, but you know, it's kind of like the sister state. What you see there really does happen in New Hampshire frequently.
It's crazy.
It is crazy.
Crazy. There's some wild stuff, and there's some really interesting stuff on there.
Yep. It was just nice to see, like, hey, that's my lifestyle right there while I'm watching this. So if you ever want to check out what lifestyle, in New Hampshire is like for the hunter, check out, Northwoods Law on Netflix.
It seems to be a great show.
It would be. I don't know who to interview, though, because they're all game wardens, and I'm not sure that they would get on the show. I guess they could get a game warden perspective.
Yeah, that's something we can work on, is trying to get a game warden on.
Right.
And, you know, just see it from their side. And you know, they're outsiders looking in. They don't make the laws, but they actually, you know, they make you abide by them. And that's part of their job. That's why the laws are there.
Right.
You got to follow them. You know, respect your game warden. Don't hate him because he had to write you a ticket for breaking the law. You know, that's why the law's there. And that's just part of their job. You know, I respect the game warden. They're different than the police officer. There's laws out there. We got to abide by them.
Right. Right. It is kind of funny though, watching some of those things. I mean, there was one of the guys, we were watching it last night, and there's a lady, who didn't know much about hunting, got concerned that there was a deer trap in her backyard. And this is, during the winter. And so he called in the game warden, and the game warden walked out back, and all it was a rack catching type system where it's like a semicircle, of some mesh wire and some feed down there and some cameras. So as the deer reached down to grab some of the feed, the antlers that were probably loose in February or so dropped off, and it got caught up in the wire system. That's all it was.
Yeah,
it was an antler trap.
Yeah, we call it a rack trap here
rack
in
trap.
Ohio.
Yeah, rack trap. Well, you have racks in Ohio. No, we don't. We
you
have,
guys just call them antlers, huh?
We just call them antlers.
Or right on, right on.
Horns sometimes. But
hey, let's get into the show here, Jay. Man, I'm pumped up about this one. I am pumped up. Folks, we are getting ready to call Kenyon Bankston from Southern Boys Outdoors.
Are you kidding me?
Well, I'm not kidding you. I'm ready to call him up.
Let's do it, man. What's the number? Kenyon, welcome to the show.
Hey, man. How y'all doing tonight?
We're doing pretty good. We're
awesome.
We're pretty pumped up to speak with you.
Oh, I appreciate that. I appreciate y'all giving me the opportunity to call in and talk to you.
We're psyched. What's going on down in your neck of the woods?
Right now, we set up in Faraday, Louisiana, in my hunting club. We pretty much is all fair chase hunting clubs and private land and stuff like that. And we're actually filming a hog hunting show this week with the Hold a Hog Hog Traps. Got Mr. Bob up here with me, and we're filming. He's got a unique trap, and that's what we're doing this week, is filming hog hunts.
Oh, excellent. Very nice. Now, you're in Louisiana, correct?
Correct. Yeah, we're in Louisiana.
Very nice. Now, Louisiana, how's the deer hunting down in Louisiana?
Our deer hunting is great down here. You know, I hunt in the north and I hunt in the south. So we got property right on the Iowa border in Missouri. And then we hunt down here in South Louisiana, and we hunt in Faraday, Louisiana, which is not far. We're only about 7 miles from the world famous Giles Island, you know, where everybody wants to go deer hunting at. The club that I'm in, we have 24 members, 3,500 acres, and, that's where I hunt at. You get your stand locations, you got to set your own stands up, and we hunt, you know, we hunt the deer.
Gotcha. One of the things that, I think we want to cover, today is, the rut. And if you could, you have a lot of experience hunting. It looks like you guys do really well hunting, deer down in Louisiana. And you got a TV show for it, so I guess you're doing pretty good.
Right.
I'd like to just touch on the rut for a little while, if we could. What exactly is the rut?
Well, you know, the rut is a breeding period of the white-tailed deer. That's when the buck's neck swell up, and it only happens one time a year. You know, the bucks run together all year. They buddies, they sleep by each other, they hang out each other, and then when that time of the year they go crazy, the velvet falls off their horns, the horns get hard, they start fighting each other and start chasing these women around the woods up here. And, you know, the rut in Louisiana, the South, complete South, the rut it usually runs from mid-December, end of December, all the way into January, February. We'll have bucks still chasing even after deer season in February in the South. You know, and what triggers that is that the deer, they can have their fawns later in the year because we don't have a harsh winter in the South, where it's different in the North. You can pretty much pinpoint exactly what day all the breeds going to take place, because the deer in the North have to be born, you know, within 6 months, they have to be born in that April and May to be able to make it through the wintertime. Where in the South, you know, we've seen deer today riding around our club that still had spots on them. Those with little bitty deer that were just born. And in that case, they wasn't bred to March. So, you know, the rut is a funny thing in the South. It's hard to pinpoint. The rut is hard to hunt in the South. North, very easy to hunt to run. Everybody wants to go. Being in the Midwest, November the 11th, that's the main time of the year. So, you know, that's my experiences of the rut.
Gotcha. Okay. Dusty, what do you have for questions?
You know, getting into that rut a little bit deeper, the north versus the south on the rut, you know, that sounds like that's a southern rut. Sounds like it's a major, it runs like 3 or 4 months, maybe five. That's,
oh, yeah.
You know, That's no something doubt. That's unpredictable and probably going to be hard to hunt the rut in the south.
Yeah, you know, in our rut time, our time when we say, you know, this is most of the time the deer are being bred in, is at Christmas and New Year's week. It falls the last week of the year and the first week of the year. Usually is when our rut, that's about when you want to be in the woods. But, I mean, we go all the way into February and March. We're doing squirrel hunts in February, and we got bucks chasing does in February and March, you know. So it's kind of weird down here.
That's craziness.
But what triggers that is that the does, you know, the doe don't have to be bred at a, she don't have to have her fawns at a certain time. You know, she can have her fawns in August and they'll make it through the winter here in the south.
Right, yeah, the
and
weather.
I hope everybody's following me on that. When they have a harsher winter up north, you know, those fawns need to be born in April and May to be able to make it through. So that's why the deer are bred at that particular, you know, the 1st of November, just about the whole north is in the rut.
Right on. Is that, what's the signs? What's some of the signs that you know that your deer are starting to get in the rut in the south?
Well, you know, we'll start seeing the scrapes and the rubs, and we call them hookings down here, and everybody calls them rubs up north, where the deer go in and they hook the trees and they make them a good hook line, or that's what we call it. They call it rub lines up north. Down south, we call it hookings, and they'll just, you know, go through there and rip the trees up, and they'll have scrapes, you know, where they scrape the leaves back right underneath a hanging limb most of the time. And, you know, a buck will come in there and he'll put his back legs together and he'll rub that back two hops and he'll pee down his legs, that buck will, and his hops turn black and he'll pee in that scrape. But then a doe, she'll come along, and when that doe comes in season, she's going to walk up to that scrape and she's going to rub them back hocks together and she's going to pee down her back legs. And she's going to let that pee run down her legs and go over them hot and run down in that scrape. And then she's going to walk off. Well, when that buck or a buck smells that hot doe, brother, you can put whatever you want in between him and her. He's going to her. You can be standing there in bright orange. And when she's hot, he's going to her. And she's going to pull in all kinds. So then you start seeing the bucks running around chasing the does, looking for does, chasing hot does.
Yeah, it's very similar up here. That's for sure. Once they get into the rut, I don't think a freight liner is going to stop them.
Oh, no. Nothing's going to get in between them except for a 30-06 or a bow and arrow.
That's right on. Right on. Hey, I like, you know, Jay, that may be a new phrase for us up here in the north is hookins.
Hookins.
Yeah,
yeah, that's
I like
what we
that.
Call it down here, hookins.
I like that. I really do. Jay, what do you think about that, calling it hookins on a big rub line?
I think it's a better description.
I think you're right. I have to agree to that.
Because
it's kind of funny, you know, when we go up north and I'm talking to people from up north and I say, yeah, man, we got a lot of hookings in the woods. And they say, what in the heck is a hooking?
Right on. I think we need to get that word involved with the northern hunters. That's for sure. A hooking line. I like that.
Yeah.
You know, it fits the antlers. You know, the antlers get in there, they get hooked on the trees. It's a hooking line.
Yep.
And you know how we describe it down here in the south, you know, we go, they say, man, I went in the woods over there and they got hookings up and down that bayou over there. I mean, they
I like
just
that.
Rip the trees up, you know.
I like that. Jay, what do you think about that?
I think that's awesome. Yeah, it's, you know, it's kind of funny when we start talking to people across the country, every part of the country has a little different, idiosyncrasy about how you do things, what you call things. It's kind of fun. I've learned that from Dusty, and he's learned some verbiage from me from up in the north. It's kind of varied, it's very fun to learn about how everybody's view upon different, the exact same thing. Hookings, scrapes.
Right.
It's kind of neat.
The licking branch. You guys have licking branches in the south?
Oh yeah, yeah. They'll come in there and they'll, you know, they rub their horns all up in it and lick on it and everything else. And what they're doing, they're rubbing their eyes because they have scent glands in their eyes and they rub in the base of their horns. So they rub their head all up in the limbs, you know, just letting them know that, you know, who they are. You know, that's how they identify each other, is by smell. So.
Right on. Is that something that you suggest to hunt along a licking branch trail, like where they've got some scrapes on the ground, they got a couple of licking branches? What do you think about hunting along a setup like that?
Well, you know what I do, and what a lot of people do. You know, you get your, you know, there's different deer peas out there. Your deer different deer attractants. You know,
mm-hmm.
and what we do, we'll go in and we'll put it on a drag rag, and we'll go up to a scrape and we'll drop some in a scrape, and then we'll take off with that drag rag with that dopey on it, and we'll pull it all through the woods, and we'll pull it down that scrape line, and we'll come to another scrape and we'll put some more in it, and then we'll put it on the drag rag, and then we'll circle around and we'll go to where we go hunt at, and we hang that scent up, that drag rag up, and then we climb in a tree and then you hunt that scent line. And most of the time when a buck smells that, he's coming down and you're gonna bring him to you, because he's gonna think it's a hot doe.
Yeah, and I'm glad you got into detail on that, because, you know, we're doing this to help out somebody that's looking to hunt the rut and learn a few extra tips from, somebody like yourself that's experienced during the rut hunting. That's a great tip. You get your urine out on a drag rag. You work them scrapes and turn it right to your hunting spot, right to your tree stand set up. That's dynamite there.
Right. And you know, something else on that, you know, I hear people and I've seen people and I've done it myself, but you know, you take that deer pee, your Tinks, your Code Blue, all the major brands, and you squirt them on the bottom of your boot, and you walk through the woods and you get up in a tree. And you know, that's really a mistake, especially when you're bow hunting, because you know, that buck can smell. I'm telling you, he can smell you from a mile away. And when he comes through there and he's smelling and he smells that hot doe, that doe urine, he's going to look up at you. And I hear, you know, a lot of people out there is going to say, oh, I want him to look at me. Well, you know, not really. Not if you're trying to draw back your bow, get your gun around to get on him. You don't want him looking at you. So what I do, I keep my doe scents, my attractant, I keep them on drag rags and on cotton balls, and I use them, and then I use my cover scent, you know, my earth scent, my pine, my cedar scent, my cover scent, I put that on my body, spray my boots down with the cover scent, I hunt, and that way the deer is focused down where I want to kill him at, and he's not focused like looking up, smelling, you know, the deer, the hot doe coming out about 15 foot over his head. You know,
right,
he's concentrating on the ground. Yeah. And, you know, I started doing that a few years ago, and I tell you, after you get busted a couple times by a buck because he comes up behind you and he's smelling a hot doe up in a tree, and then you trying to turn around and get on him and he's sitting there looking at you, and then you change your pattern up. You start putting them on a drag rag and keep your attractants on drag rags and keep them down in the area where you want to kill the deer, and keep your cover scent on your body up in a tree. You'll see more deer and you'll kill more deer that way.
Yeah, that's a great tip right there. You know, that's from trial and error, and that's what we like to hear. It makes sense that a big monster buck won't be coming in to a smell that's 15 foot in the air. That's out of the ordinary.
Right. Well, he's going to come to it, but he's going to be looking at you, and you don't want
right
him,
on.
You know, and I tell people that, you know, I do a little, events different places, and I speak at different places, and I tell people that, and they say, oh, I want that deer to look at me. No, you don't want him to look at you. You don't want him to look at you, promise.
Right, yeah, you try and draw a bow, them two eyes are going to pick you out every time trying to draw that bow back.
Yeah, you don't want him looking at you.
That's pretty interesting that, you know, I guess I never really thought about it like that, but that's exactly what would happen. If you don't have scent on the ground, you're going to get busted.
Right.
That's a great tip.
That is a great tip. Excellent.
You don't really think about it, but that's spot on. That's exactly what's going to happen. Excellent.
You know, and we use our trail cameras. You know, I use 5-point trail cameras. You know, I mean, they done me right. I ain't never had a spy point film, and we use that, and we put that over the scrapes. We find a scrape, a good scrape where the buck's coming in there. And we put that our trail camera, and we get that picture of that buck where we know what we hunt. And you can put, and when you got a scrape, you know it's more than one buck working that scrape. You put your camera on there, and you're going to get you probably three or four different bucks, or maybe four or five coming in there working that same scrape.
Gotcha.
A lot of people don't know that, but that, you know, it ain't the same buck working that scrape. You
that's
have
interesting.
Every buck in the woods is going to work that scrape.
Very interesting.
Yep. But trail cameras nowadays is very valuable, because then you know what you hunt in the area. When you see a buck, you know that you've seen him before, and you know whether he's a shooter or not. And I really believe in trail cameras. And I mean, I take thousands and thousands of pictures a year using the trail cameras.
Can you elaborate a little bit on that subject and share with us what kind of cameras you're using and how you set them up? Like, what's your strategy for positioning them?
I use the spy point cameras. That's what we use. They're available at, you know, your Bass Pros, Cabela's, stuff like that, Gander Mountain. And what we do, we go in, we set them about knee high off the ground. And I always set my camera to take a picture 1 minute intervals, you know, every minute that something moves in front of it, it'd take three pictures. I like a lot of pictures because I hear people say, okay, I set it to take one picture every 5 minutes. Well, you know, if that big buck walks in there, or that doe or whatever walks in there, and it triggers that camera to take one picture, well, that big buck could walk in there and be gone in 5 minutes, and you'll never have his picture. So I like taking a lot of pictures. I said 1 minute, three pictures. I know it's a lot of pictures to go through, but when that buck comes in there, I want to look at him from the side. I want to look at him from the other side. I want to look at him from the top. I want to look at him from every way. I want every picture I can get of him. So that's why I set and take so many pictures.
Gotcha. Will you put two cameras on one spot, or do you just do one?
Most time I just do one. You know, down here in Louisiana, and you know, you hear a lot of flack about it. Oh, you can hunt over feeders. Yeah, well, you know, it's legal. We can hunt over feeders. We don't have big cornfields like they do in the north. You know, we have thickets. I mean, we have thick woods. You can see about 150 yards, and that's pretty much it. And we got so many oak trees. It's just completely oak trees. You know, you get down south, you'll get into more piney wood trees. But, you know, we mainly hunt with overfeeders down here, and we feed year round, and we put our cameras up, and we get pictures year round.
Excellent. How many cameras are you working at one time?
Right now I got eight cameras out right now.
Okay. Gotcha. And how many square miles are you working?
I got two set up. You know, the spy point has an awesome video part in it.
Okay.
I actually videoed an alligator in Louisiana climbing a tree with a 5-foot camera at night.
Whoa.
And they ain't never seen that on Swamp People, but I did. I got an alligator, a 7-foot alligator. He comes up and he climbs up a tree, comes out of the water, all four legs, comes all the way up, puts his nose on the camera and goes back down. Got it on video. Pretty cool video. And then, you know, just the video sections of those cameras nowadays is just so awesome. I mean, I get some beautiful video. And when you can get a video of a deer walking in and when he's turning and all that, I mean, it's just so valuable because you can see his horns everywhere. You can see everything about that deer, whether he's injured or not. You can tell whether he's limping or what, you know. So I like the video parts. Right now we got them set up on our hog sets, on our hog traps, for when the hogs go in there, we're going to try video and the hogs being caught tonight on the cameras.
That's cool. I know some cameras do video, some don't. Did you choose this camera because of the video feature?
Oh, you talking about SpyPoint?
Yep.
I chose SpyPoint. You know, SpyPoint's a big sponsor of Southern Boys Outdoors. That's what put us on television.
Yep.
But I used their product. I used their product for 2 years before they ever become a sponsor of Southern Boys Outdoors. I believed in their product before they ever sponsored our show.
Gotcha. That's pretty cool. I like the video idea because it just seems like you get a little bit more coverage with video. You don't miss anything. That's great.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, you can tell whether the deer is injured. You can tell exactly what's going on with it. It's something else. You know, nowadays, everybody's filming hunts. Everybody wants to film hunts. Man, I want to film hunts. And what we do, and I take the SpyPoint camera and I turn it on video and I set it up on the other side of where I'm trying to kill the deer at.
Yep.
So when that deer comes in, I get the video from the arrow coming out of the deer on the other side of the deer. I
mean, that
makes
cool.
For some cool footage, you know?
That's cool.
And then we use the, you know, everybody's talk about the point of view cameras where they hook them to their bows and they can hook them to their guns. And we use the XL hunt cameras. They made by SpyPoint. Awesome little camera, but they designed just for hunters, man. I mean, they come with everything to mount it to a bow. They come with everything to mount it to a gun. They come in a camouflage case already. I mean, it's just an awesome little point of view camera for your bows, and anybody that says I'm a great deer hunter. I ain't gonna tell anybody. I don't say I'm the best out there and I know everything about hunting. But anybody that says, you know, I done kill some nice bucks, you know, and it's just easy. Well, I lay a challenge down. Okay, now pick you up a camera and film yourself killing a buck, and then that will add a whole nother dimension of trying of you know, harvesting deer is by filming it.
Yeah, that's a whole other level of difficulty. You just added another variable.
Oh man, yeah. If you got a cameraman, you put another man in a tree with you, which we Southern Boys Outdoors film a lot of our own hunts. I mean, I hadn't had a cameraman with me all year. I film all my own hunts. My wife Tanya, she comes with me a lot of times and runs the camera. Mm-hmm. And every now and then I have a cameraman if I know, especially when the rut, when it's going to be fast and furious, you know, I have somebody go with me, one of my friends or something, and help me.
Gotcha. And what was the name of that camera again? The XL what?
It's the XL hunt camera by SpyPoint.
Gotcha.
It's an awesome little camera, man. I mean, they're available at Bass Pro, Cabela's. Look them up online, xlhunt.com. Awesome little camera, man.
Cool.
I just videoed here in Louisiana, our hunting club. We got to kill we got a president of our hunting club, and you know, he comes up with a rule this year. You got to kill two does before you can kill a buck because we have so many does. Now, if you don't kill two does, if you kill a buck in between your two does or before you kill does, you get a $500 fine. So that makes us go out and kill does. And you know, I don't totally agree with it, but you know, I've killed one doe and I got another doe to kill. We use kill in the south. Y'all use harvest in the north. That's another speaking, you know, but harvest another two more does to harvest. Well, I got one more to harvest up here in Faraday.
Gotcha. So, and I think that kind of, that kind of thing happens, the further north you get, the less doe kill you're trying to achieve. And then the further south, the more doe kill you're trying to achieve, just because of the climate. The climate, kind of lays its hand to having more deer, in more southern climates. So, I can see that. If you have to control the population more, you're going to want to, take out some does first.
You know, anytime we here in this hunting club I'm in Faraday, at any given time you can set. We on the Tensaw River. You can set on the Tensaw River levee in the evening time, and you can count 30 and 40 does. So you know, just this season when we was riding out of the woods, we seen 12. You know, so I mean, it's a lot of deer there. It's a whole lot of deer. So
that's a lot.
And we need to take some of them out, but we don't need. I didn't think we needed a $500 fine if a big buck walks out, and we already paying $3,500 a year to be in the club, you know. So
right. That's it's pretty interesting. Like I'm in New Hampshire, so if I see a deer, it's a big deal because the population is not. I think we have in total about 75,000 deer. That's it in the whole state. So if like this morning when I was dropping my kids off at school, I saw two deer in a field that I don't usually see them in. In fact, I don't usually see them anywhere along the way to school. But they were there watching the traffic go by, and it really stuck out. I'm like, wow, you know, so that to see 40 in a night or while you're watching is a lot. That's, I would fall out of my tree stand if I saw 40 deer at one time.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing over here. You know, and then where we at, you know, we got bear on our club. We got hogs by the millions. You know, hogs is just overpopulating the south. We got deer. We got awesome squirrel hunting, rabbit hunting, and then we got, predator hunting with bobcats and coyotes and stuff. So here, you know, I mean, and we even fixing to do, we're going to do some coon hunting here in the next few weeks. We're going to do a coon hunting show. I love doing coon hunting shows because that's where my grandpa, all my pictures I got of my grandpa hunting was coon hunt pictures, you know. And then hog hunting is the first form of hunting that I'd done. You know, when I'm 45 now, and when I was 5 years old, I had a BB gun, and my stepdad would bring me hog hunting, and the dogs would bait the hogs up, and we would go in there and shoot the hogs in the head. And that was my first really form of hunting was hog hunting. So, man, I love hog hunting.
Hog hunting is something that I haven't had a great deal of experience doing, but would certainly love to get into it a little bit more. We don't have a lot of hogs up in the north. If they are here, they escaped some from a game preserve back in the 30s during a big hurricane. But it's like we have to travel to get to certain spots, North Carolina, Georgia, Louisiana. Those are the places that we have to travel to where the really good hog hunting is.
Right. You know, in a hog, you know, just touching on you can take one sow and one boar, and that sow can have three litters in a year. And I say litters because they have 10 to 12, you know, so if they have 10, that's 30 more pigs. And that first litter that she had, if she had five sows in her first litter, at the end of the year, when they a year old, every one of them sows can have a litter. That's how, and if you start doing the math on it over a 2 year period, how many hogs can come from just two? It's amazing. It's unbelievable.
That's unbelievable.
It seems like it's almost like they're getting out of control.
They are. You can't control them. You just got to maintain them. That's all we can do. You know, I mean, it's just, you kill them, you trap them, you hunt them, you trap them, and you just, you know, and it's just a never ending process, you know.
Multiplying.
You think that, oh man, we killed 40 off this 200 acres, we killed 40 hogs, and then the next day you go up there and you got 15 or 20 in the field, and you're like, man, where'd they come from? You know, it's just crazy.
That's a lot of hogs.
Yeah.
Can you tell us about what your most memorable hunt was?
My most memorable hunt, I was in Missouri, Clark County, Missouri, and I was bow hunting. And we went up there, and man, I mean, it was the last day, and that we had on this hunt. It was a do-it-yourself farm. They showed you the boundaries of the farm, 605 acres, five of my buddies, and he said, here's the boundary lines. You hang your own stands, you hunt it, and it's yours. And it took me a while to figure it out. That was the first time I really ever hunted out of Louisiana. And, you know, and hunting in the north on November the 11th was very, very different. I mean, because it was rut and bucks were running everywhere. And it had this nice 8-point, 120-inch 8-point, which ain't a very big deer for around there. But down south where I'm from, 120-inch deer, I'm talking about down south Louisiana, not in Faraday, down south where I live at and I hunt a lot at. If you kill a 120-inch deer, that's a monster buck down there. You know,
right.
That's a huge buck. Our deer average around 80 inches to 100 inches, you know. So I got this 120 that's just ripping up a scrape across a fence like 100 yards from me. So I take that grunt and I aim it right at him and I grunt. When he stops, he turns, he pees in the scrape. He rubs him back hocks together, he pees in that scrape. And he's kind of walking with his legs bowed out. And he's looking towards me, but he don't know where I'm at. He's just looking towards the woods I'm in.
Mm-hmm.
And I just grunt loud as I can at him. Man, he stops. He throws his ears up, and he takes off running to me. I'm talking about running wide open. He runs, jumps the fence, comes in, circles around, and he comes to the grunt one time now. This is how good they can hear and pinpoint sound.
Yeah.
I grunt one time at this deer. He comes, and he comes straight to the tree I'm in, and he looks straight up at me. And I'm looking straight down at him with my bow pulled back, and I shoot, and I miss him. He circles around in the woods. I'm grunting at him, and to my right side, there's a fence post, and that fence post is 54 yards, and there's a deer trail. They get deer trails up north, and I mean, it's like a cow trail going around the fence, and he's walking down that fence, and I said, he's going to be 52 yards from me, and I turned, I knocked another arrow, and when he hit that opening, I grunted at him again. He stopped, and I let that arrow fly, and I mean, I just watched it fly all the way to him, 52 yards, and hit perfect, and he run off about 40 yards and died over him, man. That was probably one of my most memorable hunts, because just I got to see everything on that hunt. I got to see the chasing, the scrape making, the reaction of the deer from the grunt. I mean, it was just an awesome hunt.
That's great.
That's insane.
Next to my alligator hunt when I jumped out of the boat on an alligator, you know. Well, yeah. That was an awesome hunt.
Yeah. I mean, it's deer hunting versus alligator hunting. We'll talk about that. That's a different show.
But, yeah.
Dusty, what other questions do you have?
Kenya, what's the one of your best tips that you've learned over the years that you'd like to pass along to everybody? Give us like a good detailed tip that you picked up in the whitetail woods that made you more successful and a better hunter.
You know, if the best tip that I can tell anybody and that I started really believing in is that go back to what we were talking about earlier. When you go and you got your Tink 69, you got your Code Blue, you got your Black Widow, you got whatever deer lure you got, keep it on a drag rag, keep it on a cotton ball, keep it in the area that you're hunting, and use your cover scent, your bird scent, your pine scent, your cedar scent, you know, whatever scent you want to put on you. You put that on your body and you get in your tree or in your stand and you leave your attractant in the area where you're hunting at. That is the best tip I can give anybody.
That's excellent. That's a great tip. Yeah, it really is. That's, hopefully somebody takes that, and uses it while they're headed into the woods and makes them a little more successful at, chasing the whitetail. Let's get into Southern Boys Outdoors. You got it rocking on your Facebook. I gotta say, you got a rocking page, and tell us a little bit about what you guys got going on.
Man, look, I started Southern Boys Outdoors 4 years ago, and met a lot of good friends in the industry. Alex Rutledge with Bloodline is a real good friend of mine, and he's helped me out tremendously. Well, I started this Facebook page. When I started this Facebook page, you know, and I started learning Facebook and how Facebook operated. And I seen, you know, I watched so many shows go and come on the Pursuit Channel. in Sportsman Channel. You see them there one year. They finance their house. They finance everything, and they put yourself on TV, and they think the sponsors are going to come to them, and they're going to have sponsors because they have airtime. And I said, you know, the best thing I can do is reverse this. I need to build my social media. And I said this 3 years ago. I got to build my social media, because if I can get my social media strong, then the sponsors will come for my TV show. And man, it just took it, and it just started taking off. I mean, I worked with a group called the WPM Group, Todd Copenol and them. And, you know, once I started working with Todd, he taught me some stuff about Facebook, and we shared information and about Facebook. And then, man, it just started rocking, man. I mean, I keep my page interesting. I make, you know, comical posts, funny posts, and then I tell about giveaways, and I tell about hunting, and you know, we just talk about everything on there. But one of the things that really amazes me, and I'm really touched by it, is that in the last 7 days, we reached 24 million people. We've reached more people than Duck Dynasty in the last 7 days, and that's totally amazing.
That's insane.
That's outstanding. Very nice.
And then in the last 7 days, we had 2.7 million people either liked or commented something on Southern Boys Outdoors. 2.7 million people in the last 7 days.
That's awesome.
And that's like, man, that's just unbelievable. That's crazy numbers. But, you know, I run my page just like it's a television show, and you're going to see commercials on there, my sponsors. You're going to see them on there, and I make a, you know, I put a picture up from them. I talk about them sometimes. You know, I gotta support those guys that support me.
Right.
And it just all comes together, and, you know, where all these people come from, I don't know. I don't know where they hear about us from, but, you know, I get anywhere from 100 emails a day. You know, it's great.
Right.
Right. I see that you're on the Hunt Channel.
Yeah, we play on the Hunt Channel Thursday nights at 8 o'clock. That's only on Dish Network, Channel 266. Last week was a hog show. This week we go turkey hunting with the Wounded War Heroes in Pachuta, Mississippi. The Wounded War Heroes is an awesome group, man. I mean, they do a lot for the veterans, and just being able to go and sit around a campfire. I've done 6 shows with the veterans. And I went, and when you go and you sit around a campfire with these guys, and they tell you how they was injured in war, how they fought, how they were shot, how they were blew up, and how they survived, and how they went down in helicopter crashes and survived. When you start hearing them stories, man, I'm telling you, it'll bring tears to your eyes. And it makes you have so much more respect when you see a veteran that's injured. I mean, it just makes you like, man, you just like, man, I can't believe. And it makes you wonder what he went through, because you heard stories what the other ones went through.
Right.
And that's what our show is about. We go turkey hunt with our veterans, and man, we have an awesome hunt. And then I think we go crabbing, man. We got a crabbing show. Has anybody ever heard of a crabbing show? we go crabbing in South Louisiana, and we have a Louisiana crab ball on the, and I got at my camp down there, I got these big cypress trees come through the deck, and we ball crabs and we eat them.
I love crab.
And that's what kind of draws people to us, is because we do so much different stuff.
Right.
You know, we do squirrel hunts, rabbit hunts, crabbing shows, spear fishing shows where we dive down and shoot catfish in the stumps with spear guns, alligator hunting, hog hunting. We do everything, man.
That's very cool.
And, you know, Southern Boys Outdoors, let me tell you, Southern Boys Outdoors ain't Kenyon Bankston. Southern Boys Outdoors is a group of people. You don't have to be from the South to be in it. It's just Southern Boys Outdoors. It's a culture of what people live in and the way they live, whether they're from the North or whether they're from the South. It's just, you know, hey, if you like deer hunting, you like squirrel hunting, you love the outdoors, you like fishing, then, you know, that's, you know, portrayed as a Southern Boys lifestyle there. And that's another thing that draws people to us, is because it's just, you know, it's a Southern Boy style life of, you know, and it's just Southern Boys Outdoors.
Gotcha. Can we run through some of the players on the show? Just so we can get to know them a little bit better on the podcast here. Kenyon, that's you. Kenyon, you grew up in Louisiana?
I was born and raised in Pumpkin Center, Louisiana.
Beautiful.
And, something else about me, I've been married to my wife for 27 years. We started dating in high school, pretty blonde. She was walking in the mall, and I told my buddy, I said, there's my kid's mama right there. And I run down there.
Wow.
And we've been together ever since.
And that's Tanya?
And,
and we got two kids. I got a son, 26, and I got a daughter, 24, and I got two grandkids, and both of my kids are married, both have their own places, and, you know, we got a good little family going.
That's awesome. Now, that your wife is Tanya, is that correct?
Yeah, Tanya, yep. Okay. She's on the show with us. She helps us co-host some. She runs the camera some, and we have another guy, Leon Stilley, out yes. of Albany, Louisiana. And Leon is a 12-time Louisiana State Goblin Champion, Turkey Goblin Champion. And he's won the Alabama State Championship. He's won different state championships across the South in turkey hunting. Awesome turkey hunter. And then we have Terry Heron. Terry Heron is a Paul Landale machine to me. and he is just country as country can be, Terry. And you know, these guys bought their own cameras and started filming, with me. I got a group. Victor and William out of Texas, they're going to be sending in footage to us. You know, and anybody out there that films their hunts or interested in filming their hunts, you know, they can get in touch with me. They can call me on the cell phone, 985-969-5834. You call, talk to me about it, send me an email, southernboysoutdoors@yahoo.com. Tell me you're interested, you film your own hunts. You know, if you send a video in, and it's good, it's going to be good, pretty good quality video. It can't be real shaky and anything, but call me, I can go over all that with you. And if you want to film your hunts, you want to see yourself on television, Southern Boys Outdoors, hey, I invite you to join us. Start filming your hunts and send the footage to us.
That's cool. Now, who is, tell us about the McDonald's, Debbie, Danny, and Jay.
Well, that's a good friend of mine. He lives across the street. Danny's a beer man. He works for Miller Beer, his wife. Me and Danny just go way back, man. I mean, he was the first person on the show with me. Now, he didn't film as much as he used to, and he ain't on the show as much as he used to be, him and his brother, but, we do a Southern Boys Outdoors Youth Camp. They're there every year, teaching the kids different things about tree stand safety, fishing, archery, and gun safety. They're there all the time with me. No matter what I do, they're there with me. And, you know, they'll be on maybe two or three shows a year.
Gotcha. And how about Paul LeBlanc?
Oh, Paul LeBlanc?
Yes.
Yeah, Paul LeBlanc. That's just an old crazy friend of mine there. Me and Paul go way back, man. He's a jokester, man. He's my rabbit hunting buddy. He goes rabbit hunting with me and just a real good friend. He makes probably about two or three shows. He's my cook. He does all the cooking when we have Southern Boys Outdoors events down here, and he can cook a mean pasta live. I mean, it's just awesome.
Sounds like a good guy to have in camp.
For sure.
Yeah.
That's very cool. All right. So I got to ask you a question. I've been watching some of your videos and I look at all your pictures and every single picture, every video, looks like everybody holds their hand out, spreads their fingers apart and makes sure that you got at least four fingers in the shot. And it's some kind of a sign. I don't know what it is. Can you explain
I had a group back in 94, 95, and we used to film and do everything and never really put it together as a television show, but we called ourselves Team Fourth Ward.
Gotcha.
And that's where we live at now, is Fourth Ward, Louisiana. And we would just hold our, and we hold our four fingers up. Well, when I started Southern Boys Outdoors, I'd done a coon hunt and I was just talking, and I had done it on the Team Fourth Ward, but I knew that I didn't really, I mean, I liked the name, but I just wanted that Southern Boys Outdoors name. And I'd done that four fingers, and I'd done it on about the first five shows. Well, I walk in a Subway in Robert, Louisiana.
Yeah.
And the lady turns around and she said, "Oh my God, you're Kenyon Bixon from Southern Boys Outdoors." I said, "Yes, ma'am." She said, "I'm mad at you." I said, "Mad at me?" She said, "Yeah, my 5-year-old grandson runs around the house doing his Southern Boys hand sign, SBO hand sign, and you didn't do it last time." I said, "Yes, I did." She said, "Oh no, you didn't do it."
That's really cool.
So when I left out, I called my wife and I told my wife, "You know something? I said, that little stupid hand sign that I do, it's called on. I mean, and if I don't do it, I get people to get mad.
Right.
And then I get people to get mad because I do it. So no matter what we do in life or who we are or whatever, we're going to make some people mad and we're going to make some people laugh. You know, so it doesn't matter. Just be yourself. Do what you do, and you'll be okay. Some will get mad at you, some will love you."
Right. That's cool. We've come up with a saying between Dusty and I on the Big Buck Registry, and maybe you guys can start using it too. Do you know who Ed Waite is?
Who's that?
His name is Ed Waite. He is a scorer for Buckmasters.
No. I sure don't know him.
Ed Wade is, he's a friend of Dusty. He's a friend of mine. And he's one of the scorers for Buckmasters. And Dusty Great. And I have come up with a, tell him a little bit about Ed, Dusty.
You know, Ed is a great gentleman. He's a very likable guy. And, you know, over the last year or two, I've got to know him real well personally. He's right here in Dayton, Ohio, and he's a master scorer for Buckmasters Trophy Records. And, you can look him up on Facebook, Buckmasters, master scorer, Edison Waite, Ed Waite. He, you know, he's just a very likable guy, and, he puts his hands and his tape on some really nice bone, all around the world, actually. He travels quite a bit to score deer. And, you know, me and Jay one day was talking about him, and just coincidental, I think he was at a hockey game, wasn't you, Jay?
Yeah, I was at a minor league hockey game, and Dusty had texted me about doing the show, doing our podcast, and he said he typed in at the end, "Can't wait," and the phone accidentally corrected the spelling to wait as a W-A-I-T-E instead of can't wait. So ever since then, we've been saying can't wait, because if you're going to go see Ed, or if you can't wait, that means you're going to go see Ed Waite to have your deer scored, which means you just shot a really nice buck.
Right.
So long story, kind of like your hand thing, you know, it just kind of develops into some other thing. So now we just say can't
right.
wait.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's picked up around the world. People are starting to, it's a kind of a slang, just like your hand gesture that, you know, I'm starting to receive some text messages from and some emails. And at the end, for some crazy reason, can't wait pops up.
Right.
You know, it's just a pretty cool thing that, that everybody's picked up on. No different than, you know, when you guys put out your four fingers. That's, right. You know, that's Southern Boys Outdoor style.
Yep. Yeah, we say come on a lot, you know, and it's obvious, say, come on.
Nice. So where are you going to take Southern Boys Outdoors? What's the direction?
Man, look, I don't have no clue. We're right now in the process. You know, we got 218,000 or 217,000 likes on Facebook. We got sponsors calling us every day. We're looking at being on the Pursuit Channel third and fourth quarter next year. They want us to do a second quarter, Aaron, but I'm not for sure. But we definitely will be on the Hunt Channel next year on Dish Network 266. And man, we're just going to keep growing. We're going to go to the ATA show this year in Nashville, Tennessee, talk to some sponsors firsthand and just see what happens with it. You know, it's really in God's hand to all I can do is just go and go and go and keep my foot on the gas and let him do the steering. So wherever we land at, that's where we land.
Very cool. I love what you're doing with Southern Boys Outdoors. Keep up the great work. We'll be checking in with you quite frequently to see what's going on. And we'll definitely be talking about you and commenting on our podcast as things develop for you guys throughout the next year or so.
Well, man, we appreciate it. Anything we can do for y'all, just let us know. We're here, man. We're rolling along there on Facebook and just enjoy hunting, enjoy life. That's what we live for.
That's awesome. Now, if people want to get a hold of you, you kind of gave out a phone number earlier, but can you run down all your contact information again, your Facebook page, your website, and how to reach you?
Well, you know, you can look us up on Facebook at Southern Boys Outdoors, boys with a Z. You'll find us on there. And then our website is southernboysoutdoors.com. And then our email is southernboysoutdoors@yahoo.com. All of them are spelled with the Z in the boys. And then, you know, they want to call us, office number 225-209-0945, and the cell number 985-969-5834. My wife gets mad at me when I give my number out because we at Central Time, you know, we have people call me, and it'll be like 5 o'clock our time, and it'll be 6 o'clock Eastern Time, and they'll call me and like, "Hey, man, what are you doing?"
Gotcha.
Well, but I do a call in. When my show airs, I have people call in and talk to me.
Nice.
You know, say, I just put it out there on Facebook. Hey, if you want to call and talk to me during the show while you're watching the show, call me up. And I have people call me. And, you know, we have people call us from North. One night we had somebody call us from North Carolina. We had somebody call us from Michigan. We had somebody call us from New Mexico. We had somebody call us from Mississippi, which we had a bunch from Mississippi and Louisiana. And it was pretty touching when we did it, because people would say, "Man, I ain't really never talked to anybody on TV." And I said, "Well, dude, you ain't talking to anybody special. I'm just like you, you know? I'm just stupid enough to have a television show and put myself out there on everybody."
Gotcha. Well, that's very cool. Well, that's excellent. Thank you for spending some time with us, Kenyon, and going through the rut and telling us all about Southern Boys Outdoors and what's going on in Louisiana. There's the other family in Louisiana, the other hunting family. Do you guys ever get to interact?
We got quite a few. We got Chad and Dana Walls. Yeah. They're in Springfield, Louisiana. That's my neighbors. They have wall hanger television. And I have some really good friends, Brandon and Jody Carter, with Real Shot. They're from Louisiana.
Real Shot,
they have a Horseman channel. And then we have Trained Assassin, Craig Fitzgerald. They're from Louisiana. And, you know, they live right there by me. And then, of course, all them crazy swamp people in Shelby State, they all, my neighbors, they all live around me, too. So.
Gotcha. So, Louisiana is well represented there in the television hunting community.
You've got the Busbits, Matt and them, with Ball Game Innovation out of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. You know, you got them. I mean, you got a number of television shows coming out of Louisiana.
That's awesome. Very good. Excellent. Well, we really do appreciate it. Dusty, any last questions for Kenyon?
No, Kenyon, sounds like you got it going on for Southern Boys Outdoors, and we really appreciate you talking about the rut with us tonight, and We look forward to keep watching on what you guys get into over the next few years. And, you know, we wish you the best of luck.
Okay, I appreciate it, man. Thank you.
All right, Ken, we'll be in touch.
All righty. Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you.
Wasn't that awesome, Dusty?
That was an awesome podcast. You know, Kenyon there at Southern Boys Outdoors, man, I tell you what, thank you. And you're very knowledgeable for our listeners. You know, hunting the rut is a great time to be in the whitetail woods. The big boys are on their feet, and Kenyon just laid out something there that, you know, me being an experienced hunter that I am, never really put in perspective on how important it is to keep that scent on the ground, not up in the tree.
Right, right. I've never really thought about that. I mean, I've had it on my boots a little bit, but never always kind of have forgotten to put it on the ground. And it didn't make a huge difference in my hunt, but if you're surrounded by a lot of deer, that would make a big difference.
Oh, a major difference, you know. And Kenya, we sure appreciate you, you know, telling us that and giving us that tip there that, you know, it could make a difference in a lot of hunters' experience.
It's absolutely. And that the Southern Boys TV has come a long way in 4 years. I mean, he started out just kind of getting it going, but I mean, he's got how many thousands of likes on Facebook and
217,000
more than Duck Dynasty.
Wow.
I think. Or he had more viewership on his page in a week than Duck Dynasty did. That's how big these guys are becoming.
That's getting out there.
That's a lot. That's huge. Well, I'll tell you what, Dusty, I think it's time to wrap up the show. How can people reach you?
Facebook.com/ Chubby Tines Outdoors. Working on a webpage, ChubbyTinesOutdoors.com. Not quite got it all the way built up yet, but it is out there. And we're getting things rolling there, and that's how you can get in touch with me. Good luck in the woods. Be safe out there. You shoot a nice one, get it to me at Chubby Tines Outdoors right here on Facebook.
Very cool. All right, and if you'd like to reach us on the Big Buck Registry, we have a Facebook page, which is facebook.com/ Big Buck Registry. You can send an email to jay@bigbuckregistry.com. Go to our Facebook page. Our website, which is bigbuckregistry.com. And you can go to Twitter, which is twitter.com/ bigbuckregistry. And if you want to subscribe to this iTunes podcast, you can take your Apple device, your iPhone, your iPad, or whatever you have, and download the podcast app and type in Big Buck Registry. It will come up and you can subscribe from there. And if you'd like to share this podcast with your friends as you're listening to it, there's an arrow that kind of goes to the right, just a little tiny arrow in the top of your screen. Just push that and say, I want to text it to my buddy, and then they can listen to it too. Other than that, we have the phone number. If you'd like to call in a hunt that you just had or check in a big buck with us, we'd love to hear more about it. And that is 724-613-2825. 724-613-2825. So this is Jay Scott, and you're
on. Dusty Phillips.
Dusty Phillips, and we'll see you next time right here on the Big Buck Registry's Big Buck Podcast.
Can't wait.